dream is fading, now I'm staring at the door. I know it's over cause my feet have hit the cold floor. Check my reflection, I ain't feeling what I see. It's no mystery. Whatever happened to a passion I could live for? What became of the flame that made me feel more? And when did I forget that I was made to love you? With my eyes open wide, back in the ring, you got me swinging for the grand prize. I feel the haters spitting vapors on my dreams, but I still believe. I'm reaching out, reaching up, reaching over. I feel the breeze cover me, call Jehovah.
It is good, amen? Amen. Would you stand with us? He is an amazing God, worthy of praise for that we can give him. And we were going to do our very best this morning. Father, we thank you so much for who you are, for what you've done, for all that you're going to do. We thank you that you love us so much. That you're patient with us, you're kind, and you're gentle with us. Lord, and we come now to bring to you an offering of praise, Father, that would be worthy of your name. Father, not hindered by distractions of our mind, distractions of things in our lives, but that it would be all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength this morning. Holy Spirit, have your way with us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come, let us
us sing for joy. Let us shout aloud to our King. Come, let us worship God, lifting holy hands to bless His creature in heaven and earth below, bless His name, bless His name. Let every creature in heaven and earth below, bless His name, bless His name. Let every creature in heaven and earth below, bless His name, bless His name. Come, let us sing for joy, let us shout aloud, bless our King. And come, let us worship God, lifting holy hands, bless His name.
to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am. Yes, I am holding on to you.
Like a fire shut up in my bones, I want the world to know you are God. With a passion burning deep within, I want the world to know that you
Jesus, I'm desperate for you. Jesus, I'm hungry for you. Jesus, I'm longing for you. 'Cause Lord, you are.
I'm hungry for you. Jesus, I'm longing for you. 'Cause Lord, you are all I want. 'Cause Lord, you are all I want. Jesus, you are all, you're all that I want. Jesus, you are all, you are everything that I want. You are all I want. What heart could hold the weight of your love and know the heights of your great worth? What eyes could look on your glorious face, shining like the sun? What heart could hold the weight of your love and know the heights of your great worth? What eyes could look on your glorious face, shining like the sun? You are holy, 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 God most high and God most.
Jesus, you are.
Jesus, you are. Jesus, you are.
Sing, who shall we say you are?
Who shall we say you are? You're the living God. Who shall we say you are? You're the great I am, the highest name of all. You're all you say you are. You're all you say.
Praise forever.
Jesus, you are worthy to be praised. Father, we have heard with our ears, Father. We have felt it in our hearts, God. This love that you have for us. And one day our eyes will see. One day our eyes will behold you and your holiness. Holy Spirit, we ask you right now to give us the eyes to see, Lord. To give us the understanding in our ears, in our hearts, God. Let our ears hear. Lord, this love you have for us, we pray in our Savior Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
To those who have ears to hear and eyes to see, lift up your eyes, clean out your ears, and remember, no matter who you're pulling or pushing for, or even if you don't care for any of them, remember, fill your minds with the truth of God. For we have been called to be ambassadors, ambassadors of the one true King. A King whose parables reminded us that our neighbor may look and think differently, but we still need to love them. A King who talked of power coming from weakness. A King who said that peacemakers are truly children of God. A King who turned the laws of the world on its head. A King who could have commanded his army of angels to wage war against his enemies, but instead gave himself to the cross. Our King showed us that changing the world has nothing to do with political power. So remember, because we are joint heirs with Christ, our power is not tied to money, fame, or politics. Our power comes from the Creator of the universe, and He has given us the voice in this world, a voice to change the world. And our voice is strongest when God's voice speaks through us. Our voice is loudest when we are quiet before the Father. Our voice is the boldest when we humble ourselves to God. Our voice is the most influential when we swallow up all the hate in this world and speak forth with love. So do you really want to change the world? Do you? Do you really want to change the world? Then fill your hearts and minds with the truth of God. Because the kingdoms of earth will pass away, but God's kingdom, it's eternal.
Just a reminder to get out and vote if you didn't vote yet early. You can vote up to Tuesday, I believe. And Jill and I went and voted this week, and it's a tough one. It wasn't, I couldn't vote for anybody. I had to vote against. I had to look at it that way. Okay. Start from the worst and see who we got left. And so pray about it. But the good news is, if you're a believer in Jesus, you're part of God's kingdom. And we're not looking for a president. We have a King. He is on his throne, and he is in control. Our memory verse, it's interesting, for our self-confrontation class that we do after this, is Romans 8, 28 and 29. And it says, For we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed into his image, or the image of his Son, so that he might be the firstborn of many brethren. You understand what that's saying? God, for those of us that love God and are called according to his purpose, he is causing all things to work together for good. And that definition of good is conforming us into the image of Christ. That's what he's doing. He's working all things together to conform us to the image of Christ so that Christ won't be an only child. That's what he's saying, so that he'll be the firstborn of many brethren, so that we will be adopted sons and daughters. God is preparing us to be brothers and sisters of Christ in his kingdom for all eternity, and that's what he's working everything together for, that good. And what that looks like in this world might not look like good to some of us at certain times. So we won't be needing to have class this afternoon. No, I'm just kidding. There's a lot more into that, but... just some announcements. Friday night is Bible study. Is that still on, Bob? Friday night, Bob and Dana's house. Doors open at 6:30 for coffee. Study starts at 7. Also, the Wednesday night study is right here at the park and under the pavilion. It's starting to get a little cool. You probably want to bring a coat and maybe bring a mug of coffee or hot chocolate. And Daniel's going to just, as you guys, as your input, those of you that are joining us for the study, you'll call it quits at whenever it gets too harsh, I guess. Also, we're reading through the Bible, the Project 345. Here's the schedule for that. And do we have any praise reports this morning? Does anybody want to share anything? Mackenzie has one, and Carol, and he's got the mic right behind you.
Oh, okay. Well... we've been taking care of my horseback riding instructors. We've been taking care of her house. She's been on vacation. And we were there yesterday, and we were going to leave, but something happened where we ended up having to stay a little longer. And it was pretty cool because our neighbor's horses got out and were running across Highway 11. And there was a lot of traffic, and the neighbors either weren't home or they were doing something where they weren't there. And it just kind of all worked together really well because a police officer was driving by at the time, saw the horses stop traffic on one side, and then another passerby stopped traffic on the other side, and we were able to, just because we were there, we had halters and grain anyway because, you know, it's a farm. And so we were able to get the three horses and get them back home without there being any casualties. And the lady said that she'd already lost a horse on that highway before. So it was just pretty cool because... it just happened that we were 10 minutes late getting out of there, and it just worked out. So that's pretty cool.
My father-in-law, his blood count for, I don't understand this stuff, but the cancer he has prostate cancer, and it went up to 16, and now it's at 1.35. Wow. So the medicine's working. So thanks for your prayers.
Amen. James, did you have one?
We just want to give praise that Vera's here today with us. She's getting better. Thanks for all the prayers on that.
All right, I had a post-op appointment this past Monday and found out that I had three polyps that were non-benign, or that were benign, sorry. And then I went and had a mammogram done, and I got a call a couple of days after that, and they said that that was normal. So I praise God for that.
This is a small thing, but I told God if it worked out, I would... praise him, so I get to do that today. I work in a warehouse and drive big equipment around with a bunch of pallets and boxes and stuff and racks. And Thursday night, just before closing, about an hour before closing, I backed into a rack real gently and everything, but our workplace always likes to make us take drug tests whenever they can do that. So I had to take one, and when you have to take one, you have to wait, you know, till it get clear before they let you get back on anything, you know. And so I talked to God about it because I didn't really want to be off equipment. I didn't want to have to, you know, fold clothes or something like that, you know, some other little thing. And it actually worked out that before I got to work, I worked second shift, before I got to work, it had already come through in less than 24 hours, so I got to stay on equipment. So I'm praising God for that, because that's what I asked him, and he blessed me. So praise God.
I go Wednesday for my strengthening for my knee. It's been a great recuperation. So the Lord, thank you for your prayers. The surgery was good, no pain. I'm healing, and hopefully they'll give me, anyways, God is good.
Amen. All right, where to start? Got all kinds of stuff going on this week. I had not one but two brothers stand up and say they would help me with a car issue, and both of them are appreciated. Looks like we got it handled, so that's pretty cool. Various little stuff like, Lord, help me find this receipt that I need. Boom, here it comes. Just all kinds of cool stuff like that. And I have a wonderful wife back there who's sitting back at the tech desk, and I praise God for her today.
All right. All right. Does anybody have a prayer need this morning? If you'd raise your hand, we'll just get some together around you. And well, we have one here, Carol. But before we do that, Lynn's going to open us up with a prayer about for our country, and then we'll take a minute and pray, and then Scott is going to come up. He'll close us in prayer, and he's going to bring in the word for us this morning. So, Lynn?
I received a prayer this past week, and it was very apropos. With the elections coming up Tuesday, you hear all the scuttle about the presidents, but I don't think we should be looking at an individual president. But here's the prayer that I received, and I would like to pass it on to you. Be still and know that I am God. That's in Psalms 46:10. Dear beloved God in heaven, please give us a president who loves this country and everything in it stands for. Please give us a president who respects you as a one true God. Will you give us a president who will, with your help, restore this nation to its former glory the way you created her? Please give us a president who will not destroy our churches and will protect the rights of the unborn. Please help us to respect what you have given to us and not taken for granted anything else. Please, God, weaken the evil and strengthen the good, both within and without. May our eyes be open in the name of Jesus. Amen. Father, I just lift up these prayers to you this morning as each one has their own needs. Lord, we just ask that you'll hear them and that you'll answer them as we know you will.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the fact that you are a God who not only never sleeps nor slumbers, but Lord, you listen and you want to hear from your children. And Father, your word says that you have not because you ask not. And you ask, and you have not because you ask amiss. Lord, so our job is just to keep asking, keep approaching you. It sanctifies us to spend time with you, Lord. So thank you for the time and the power of prayer. And Father, it is a miracle that when we come to this place, that somehow we can't think of all the prayer requests that we have of during the week. You guard us from all those. But Lord, I know that for each of us, when we walk out this building, we go through our week, there are those things that we talk to you about, we approach you, we pray for. And Lord, I pray that you would please give everyone a heart to pray for each other, for whatever needs they have, that you might be glorified as the praise reports today were just so wonderful. So thank you, Father, for being a living God and one who cares about his children. All this in the name of our precious Messiah, Jesus. Amen. Well, good morning. It is a joy, as always, to come and see everybody here. So thank you for having us and always opening arms so wide to welcome us. We love you guys. So today, Rob was kind enough to allow me to come back. And if you recall the last time I was here, I got to talk about the foreshadowing from the Old Testament. Because you know, my heart beats to the tempo of the Old Testament. I love it. And the amazing thing is that with understanding the Old Testament, we can really expose more of the new, and we can really understand how to address a lot of false teachings out in the world today, because the Old Testament is, you know, I love analogies. And this analogy I heard was really cool. It says, you know, when you build a home and you put a first floor on, then a second floor, once the second floor is done, you don't remove the first, but it's founded upon it. Same thing with the Old and the New Testaments, right? To live in the New Testament floor, you've got to be standing on a firm foundation that's built upon the Old Testament, of course, on the foundation of our rock, Jesus Christ. So we move into, does anyone have an idea what I'm going to talk about based on this picture? What's that? Yes. Yeah, exactly. So Moses and the two rocks, that's what we're going to talk about. And if you remember, the thing that was really important last time was that the Bible says that the Old Testament is a foreshadowing for the new. So let's take a quick, I like visual stuff, so shadows, right? So this is a shadow of an object. Does anyone know what that could be, knowing that a shadow is blurry, it may be at it, the light may make the angle difficult like that one, but the substance is in the actual thing, not the shadow itself. But the shadow can give us an indication of what it is. So does anyone have an idea what that is? What's that? A light bulb, very close. A lamp post? A lamp, okay, very good. Yeah, you guys are spot on. So a lamp, right? Yeah. So here we can see that shadows can indicate what the true substance is, but sometimes you've got to be able to line it up right to be able to really understand what the substance of something is. And we know Jesus' own words, that back in Luke 24, and this is small, I apologize. I meant to make it bigger. But Jesus said specifically that he came to fulfill all which was written in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms, which, law of Moses, prophets, and Psalms, is the Hebrew Scriptures. It's the Old Testament. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the Scriptures. That's the Old Testament. That's all that was written at that point, right? So this is what he does. Now, when we look at Moses and the two rocks, we're going to be in two passages, okay? Exodus 17 and Numbers 20. So if you want to go ahead and start funneling through and tapping your iPhone, that'd be great. Okay, looking at the first rock in Exodus 17, 1 through 7, let's read it. Exodus 17, 1 through 7. Then all the congregation of the children of Israel set out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped in Rephidim. There was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people contended with Moses and said, "Give us water that we may drink." So Moses said to them, "Why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord?" And the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why is it you brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" Starting verse 4. So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Go on before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel. Also take in your hand your rod with which you struck the river and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock and water will come out of it that the people may drink." Verse 6, second part. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. So he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah because of the contention of the children of Israel and because they tempted the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" So, for me, the things, the who, what, when, why, where, and how of Scripture is really key. So we're going to take some time to look at these two passages. Now, it may be that you've already seen how this is a foreshadowing. If so, praise the Lord. My prayer is that if you haven't seen it, this will expose Jesus Christ to you and make him even more famous in your lives. And if you did see it before, that there'll be something in here that so often when we study Scripture, there are things that we just don't spend time studying after we've already seen it and we move on to another book and, oh, look at that, what a jewel that is. Maybe this, if you've already seen this, it'll remind you of how great our God is. And again, draw your heart to Jesus. So in the timeline, now, the timeline on the right-hand side, those are approximate dates, right? I mean, there's archaeology and all this stuff that goes into that, but 1600 BC. Now remember, when you move forward in time for the BC, the numbers decrease, okay? So 1600 BC is around when the new pharaoh came around that didn't know Joseph. Around 1486 is when Moses, as a 40-year-old, fled Egypt because he killed an Egyptian, and he went to Midian. 40 years later, in 1446 BC, Moses returns to Egypt as an 80-year-old man. And this is where we see in Exodus the 10 plagues that we saw that culminate in Exodus 12. And we see the Exodus itself occur, and then the commandments in Exodus 20, 19 and 20. So this is the time frame we're working with, 1446 BC. And Exodus 17 is right there. So the Exodus is at Exodus 12. Commandments is at Exodus 19 and 20. So for Exodus 17, because those chapters are written chronologically, we're right between those. So when we come into Exodus 17, that's where we are in the Bible timeline. So Exodus 17, then all the congregation of the children of Israel, how many was this? Well, we get a clue in Exodus 12 that said, then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramesses to Sukkot, about 600,000 men on foot, besides children. Now, when you think of 600,000 men, I've read less conservative numbers that say about 5 per man, 5 family members per man would put it way over 2 million. But just being conservative, 3 people per family put this very strongly at a 2 million mark, okay? All of the congregation of Israel is 2 million people. 2 million. Atlanta, city proper, doesn't have 2 million people, okay? That's a lot of people. So then they set out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin. Now, we read this and it says, it's the wilderness of Sin. What kind of sin? Was it Las Vegas? No, okay? This is a Hebrew word, and it's a transliteration from seen. So really, if you were to spell it, it would be S-E-E-N, not S-I-N, because in English, we know that word. There's a different Hebrew word for sin, okay? That's not this word. It's just thorn or clay. So they went from the wilderness of Sin, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped in Rephidim. On the right, there's a map. And the wilderness of Sin is right there. Rephidim is to the right of that, about 25 miles, okay? So obviously this is all approximates, but about 25 miles, 2 million people. And these are the same Jewish people that the scripture says very clearly are very stiff-necked, right? So imagine being the leader of 2 million people walking across that landscape, and at the end, there's no water. It's going to be a lot of complaining. So we can see, was it a surprise to the Lord that there was no water there? Clearly. Now, with every verse, with every passage, we can kind of glean something from it for our lives, keeping in context, obviously. But you know, when there are points in our lives that we feel the Lord leading us somewhere, and it's just dry, like, Lord, what's going on? If he's the one who led you there, was that a surprise to him? No. But for some reason, there's some purpose in it. So, he brought them there, and it says, the scripture says, according to the commandment of the Lord, they camped at Rephidim. So not having water there, that's exactly what his plan was for them. Now, verse 2. The people contended with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. So Moses said to them, why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord? You see, was it possible that as Moses was at the front, so everyone could see his back as they were leaving Egypt and going on that route, he wasn't carrying a camelback with him? And I love puns, so get it, camelback? So he didn't have some store of water that they would come to him and say, give us water. And he says, why are you coming to me? Why would you tempt the Lord? Moses can't create water. He doesn't have a divining stick to divine where it is. Why are you coming to me? The Lord led us here. Moses is saying, why don't you ask God for water? Why are you contending with me? So then we see the people thirsted there, and the people complained against Moses. Why is it you brought us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst? The part of bringing us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children, have we heard that before somewhere? Yeah, actually, we heard it right there. Yeah? Just before the Red Sea opens up. Now, the amazing thing to me is time frame. We saw that it's about 1446 BC. But in terms of the events of the book of Exodus, how many days has it been since that event occurred? Less than 40. Less than a month and a half, they walked on dry ground across the Red Sea, looked back, Pharaoh's army is coming after them, and the Red Sea folds on them. That miracle, less than a month and a half, they're saying, you brought us here to die. You know, it's really funny to see in hindsight, but for us, when's the last time the Lord did something like these praise reports today? Wonderful. Praise God. Give him glory. Yes. See if it's a month and a half before we say, Lord, what are you doing? It's going to happen. But our loving Father knows us and our weaknesses. So, now, Moses knew who to go to. Verse 4, so Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, what shall I do with this people? They're almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said to Moses, go on before the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel as a witness. Also take in your hand the rod which you struck the river. Which river? Which one? The Nile. Very good. Yeah, yeah. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb. Now, again on the map, I love visuals. I like to know where things are. Horeb is another name for Mount Sinai. Okay? That's the current, that's the understanding of what he means by Horeb, right? And notice just to the left is Rephidim. And that's maybe a few miles, right? So the Lord says, I'm going to be on that rock. I'll be there. Bring your rod. Get ready. And you will strike the rock, and water will come out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Now, is there any indication that the Lord is angry in what he's saying? does the tenor of what he, of the words that the Holy Spirit led these words specifically be chosen, is there any indication the Lord's upset with the people? No. Even though he's performed miracles within the last month and a half, and they're approaching Moses instead of him, and they're contending with him and asking him for water, not God for water, God shows no indication of being angry, does he? He's our loving Father. And it was his plan to bring them to a place with no water. How's that work? We'll see why later. Now, last verse of this passage. So he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah. These two words specifically mean temptation and strife or contention, right? And look at the rest of the verse. Because of the contention of the children of Israel and because they tempted the Lord. So we know exactly why he renamed this place from Rephidim to Massah and Meribah. Because there's a story to be told that when later generations would come, ah, this is Massah and Meribah. Why would this place be named contention and temptation? Oh, let me tell you the story of Exodus 17, right? This oral story to be told for generations. Now, here's an interesting thing I thought. They tempted the Lord by saying, is the Lord among us or not? This is the word of God. And by the very fact that these children of Israel, in less than a month and a half, had walked through the Red Sea, he's providing food for them that their fathers didn't know. And now they come to a place with no water. Their question could be, is the Lord among us or not? Duh. He told you he'd be there. Just because you don't see him in front of your face, is not our Father there every step of the way? So, what does this indicate an extreme lack of on their part? Yes. First, I'd say short-term memory. But then definitely faith. This lack of faith. But again, even though they showed that, God provided for them exactly what they needed, as much as they needed. 2 million people. Water for 2 million people from a rock. Can you imagine? From a single source, I think when I looked online, the population of Atlanta was maybe, I want to say 300,000, maybe 400,000, somewhere around there. So let's say just four times the population of Atlanta. Does anybody know if I'm wrong on that one? Does anyone know? Okay, so let's just assume. Let's be conservative, 300,000. Let's just say four times that is 1.2 million. Can you imagine from one source, water coming from that to give water to everyone, their children, and their livestock? What a miracle. So, now we move on to Moses and the second rock. So we put that to the side. Remember first rock experience, right? Second rock in Numbers 20, verses 1 through 13. And we're going to compare and contrast these two things because it's the only two accounts in Scripture of water coming from a rock, okay? So they're kind of significant. Numbers 21 through 13. Then the children of Israel, the whole congregation, came into the wilderness of Sin. Not Sin, Sin. In the first month, and the people stayed in Kadesh. And Miriam died there and was buried there. Now there was no water for the congregation, so they gathered together, surprise, against Moses and Aaron. And the people contended with Moses and spoke, saying, if only we had died with our brethren, when our brethren died before the Lord. Why have you brought up the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness that we and our animals should die here? Verse 5, and why have you made us come out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? Is it not a place? It is not a place of grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, nor is there any water to drink. So Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly to the door of the tabernacle of meeting, and they fell on their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take the rod. You and your brother Aaron gather the congregation together. Speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will yield its water. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock and give drink to the congregation and their animals. Verse 9, so Moses took the rod from before the Lord as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock. And he said to them, "Hear now, you rebels. Must we bring water for you out of this rock?" Then Moses lifted his hand and struck the rock twice with his rod. And water came out abundantly, and the congregation and their animals drank. Verse 12. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not believe me to hallow me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them." This was the water of Meribah, because the children of Israel contended with the Lord, and he was hallowed among them. This kind of, it's going to sound familiar, but again, time frames. I love time frames, knowing kind of what's happening. We saw that 1446 was the last thing we looked at, and between the Exodus and the commandments was where we were in Exodus 17. Now, let's look at it from Moses' time frame, because there was high tech back then, and he had Facebook. In 1407 BC is the approximate time of Numbers chapter 20. So let's just kind of get into Moses' head based on his posts, right? So we know there's these things about your memories. And it ends up that 79 years ago, Moses said, "I'm signing off a faith book, guys," because he had to run out of Egypt, right? That was the point where Moses flees Egypt in 1486. I love catching her off guard. Then in 1446, you'll see it says Moses, 1446 BC, so that's really when this happened. 39 years ago, that first time you see old friends, right? He came back to Egypt. In the same year, obviously, we see the Exodus chapter 17 that we just looked at. Yes, the water came out, right? And then in 1445, we look at, that's the point that the 12 spies went into the Holy Land. And unfortunately, 10 of them came back with a bad report, and Israel murmured against the Lord. So Moses said, "Oy, if only these guys had been more convincing." But now, we're at 1407. So look at the fact it was 38 years ago that Moses had to deal with not getting into the Holy Land right then, right? He had 79 years ago that he fled Egypt. Now, do these numbers, the fact I'm at 38, 39, 79, does that mean anything to anyone? 40 years in the wilderness, right? They're at the end of their wilderness wanderings here. What was God's judgment on the children of Israel in 1445 because they murmured at the 12 spies report? What was that? Right, that generation would die, and they would not enter into the Holy Land. We're about 2 years away from that point. Almost that whole generation has died. Moses has had to deal with these people for 40 years in the wilderness. He could be a little upset at this point, right? So now we remember what the verses said, and we think, okay, now maybe we can understand why Moses kind of had that mindset. He's been dealing with a bunch of stiff-necked people, right? So about a year, maybe 2 years away from the Holy Land, getting that 40-year wilderness over with. So now we can move forward. Then the children of Israel, the whole congregation, came into the wilderness of Sin. Again, not Sin. Sin is below. Sin is above. Spelled differently. Okay, so different words. It's not like a translation thing. It's different words. But when you say the whole congregation, we don't know how many it was. But if it ends up that whole generation of 600,000 men were dying dead, and they had multiple children. Now those children are having children. We've got to assume there was at least the same amount. Probably more, but at least 2 million again. So again, this 2 million people, according to the Lord's command, are brought to a place with no water. What's the Lord thinking? So, from the wilderness of Sin, on the right, there's the wilderness of Sin, and part of that was Kadesh, which is just to the left, right there. Okay, again, about, looks like 25 miles. Okay, so This is where they are on the map. But recognize also the clue that is given to us in Scripture, that this account is happening in the first month. That's the month of Nisan, where in Exodus 12, the Lord says, this month shall be the beginning of months, it shall be the first month of the year to you. What happens in Nisan? Does anyone remember which feast might be in the first month of the year? Passover. And what's a Passover a memorial of? The Exodus. So we're at the anniversary of the time that they left Egypt at this point in history. And they're supposed to be keeping the Passover. And so look at this. As they're keeping the Passover, 38 years in the wilderness, that one generation has been dying off because of their disobedience and their disbelief in God, as opposed to these 10 spies. Now we're seeing this where God specifically orchestrated them going to a place where there's no water. Okay? Let's get the setting of this, right? Miriam died there and was buried. Now, this is kind of like a tangent. Miriam was an important character, but a lot of times in the Old Testament, people want to know where people were buried. So we see this here. Verse 2. Now there was no water for the congregation, so they gathered together against Moses and Aaron. Again, not a surprise to the Lord. He led them there. He knew there was no water. Verse 3. And the people contended with Moses, who'd have thought, and spoke, saying, if only we had died when our brethren died before the Lord, why have you brought up the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness, and we and our animals should die here? And why have you made us come up out of Egypt to bring us out of this evil place? It's not a place of grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, nor is there any water to drink. Boy, are they passing the buck. And Moses, he's a servant. Earlier he said, why do you contend with me? Now he's just got fingers pointing at him. Why did you do this? Why did you make us come out? Don't we remember that they prayed for a deliverer? And God brought Moses? This was the answer to their prayer. Guys, how many times have we said, oh, Lord, please. I had a job years ago, and I said, Lord, please deliver me from this place. I wasn't specific. I didn't say, Lord, let me leave this place into another job. He delivered me, and I had no job. But I had to remember, praise the Lord, as I was carrying my stuff out with the layoffs, oh, Lord, I asked for this. Thank you. I think. But they asked for it. And look at their own testimony. This is not a place of grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, nor is there any water. About 38 years ago, I promised you a place. You guys believe those 10 people instead of me? Oops. Now, Numbers 20, verses 6 through 8. So Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly to the door of the tabernacle of meeting, and they fell on their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them. And the Lord said, take the rod, you and your brother Aaron, gather the congregation together, speak to the rock before your eyes, and it will yield its water. Speak to the rock. Thus you shall bring water for them out of the rock and give drink to the congregation and their animals. Now, is there any indication here that the Lord is angry? No. Speak to the rock. And I'll tell you, the Hebrew word for speak is speak. As opposed to strike earlier, which was strike. The Lord knew what he was saying. Now, unfortunately, Moses, we might be able to see now why his reaction was this way. Moses took the rod, and what did he do? He gathered them together, and his words, hear now, you rebels, must we bring water for you out of this rock? Kind of misrepresenting the Lord there a little bit, isn't he? But we might have an understanding why. 38 years, they're pointing their fingers, why aren't you bringing water? It's not his job to bring water. It's the Lord's job to provide. And so here, now, looking at rabbinic commentary, which means the commentary from the rabbis, they say one sin here not only was misrepresenting God, but also must we bring water? ooh, Moses, you're kind of stepping over the line here. You and Aaron are not the ones bringing water. The Lord is doing it. You're just the instrument. You're the hammer. At least in Exodus 17, you were supposed to be. You're supposed to be the mouthpiece in this one. And he misrepresented, and he took the role upon himself. Guys, when we're frustrated, sometimes we kind of take it on ourselves and we forget, oh, Lord, this is about you, not about me, not about my ministry. It's about you. That's what's important. So Moses lifted his hand. He struck the rock twice with his rod. He struck the rock twice with his rod. Now, is there any indication Moses is angry here? Sort of. Yeah. Now the consequence. Really, really sad. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and said, because you did not believe me. Because you didn't believe me. When the Lord says something, it's not just about obedience, it's believing him. And when we think about it, what was the sin of the spies or the congregation of Israel because of those 10 spies? What was their sin? They didn't believe him. Isaiah 53, verse 1 says, who hath believed our report? You see, to the Lord, belief is key. It's faith. It's understanding and trusting him. And because Moses didn't believe him, he didn't trust him. And on the side of that, he didn't obey him. But the scripture here says, because you didn't believe me, to hallow me in the eyes of the children of Israel. Now, hallow, to make them holy. Okay? The word for hallow actually is very close to the location they were at in Kadesh. Kadesh means holy. And they were supposed to be made Kadesh. Bless you, there's a derivation to that, but he was supposed to make them holy by this. And therefore, you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them. Now, that's not saying the congregation's not going to get there. It's that you, Moses, are not going to get there. Because now he has sinned just like the generation that didn't believe. So you're not going. Oh, I jumped ahead. Okay, so here, has anyone heard of the Midrash? The Midrash is a part of the rabbinic writings, and listen to what the Midrash has to say about this. They say that, for had Moses spoken to the rock, and it gave forth water, Israel would have said, if this rock, which neither speaks nor hears, and doesn't require sustenance, fulfills the word of the Lord, the omnipresent, how much more should we? So that's what the rabbinic mindset says, that if Moses had spoken to the rock and water had come, the congregation of Israel would have said, that's a rock and it obeys the Lord. What about us? This is the water of Meribah. Now, in Exodus 17, that was a different location on the map, and that was a place. Oh, lost it. That was a place named Massah and Meribah. This verse isn't saying that they named it Meribah. This is just the water of contention because they contended. So that's all it's saying. You know, I don't see anything. I've seen where it says Meribah Kadesh as the name of the place, and that's great to recognize the difference. But he's not saying he renamed the place like he did in Exodus 17. So, and how was the congregation still hallowed? Because the very verse before says, because you didn't believe me, what would have hallowed the children of Israel didn't happen, obviously, but they were still hallowed. God's judgment was still meted out. Moses, for his disbelief, was not allowed into the Holy Land. So the congregation still got a message out of it. Now, just again, to compare and contrast, let's quick go through this. First rock versus second rock. The Lord led the Israelites to a place where there was no water. First rock? Yes. Second rock? Yeah. The Israelites were upset with Moses a little bit for taking him to a place with no water. First rock? Yes. Second rock? Yes. We're seeing a trend here, right? The Israelites approached Moses asking why he led them to a place for them to die. Yes, they did, in both places. The Israelites clearly show their lack of faith, definitely. Moses asked the Lord what he should do. Yeah, that was the right thing to do. So he does those in both places. That's wonderful, great job. The Lord gives an indication that he's angry with the people. Not at all. Moses kind of fell short. The Lord tells Moses to what the rock? First rock? Strike, very good. And the second one? Speak to. That's right. So now we see the differences here, and we see how the people reacted. God still delivered, right? But why would he do that? Why would the Lord of heaven and earth lead his people to a place where there was no water, knowing there's a lot of people? And think of it. There are people of all ages there, parents with infants, parents with young children, parents with teenagers. When you see your child saying, "Mama, I'm thirsty," you're going to go wacko to provide for your child. So what was the Lord thinking? The purpose for it can be seen, I believe, in Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8. "And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and test you, to know what's in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. When your heart is lifted up," when your heart is lifted up, that's a bad thing, "and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, who led you through that great and terrible wilderness in which were fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty land where there was no water, who brought water for you out of flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna, which your fathers didn't know, that he might humble you, that he might test you to do you good in your end." You see, this situation that the Lord led them into, knowing there was no water, it was done to humble them. Because what they should have done was say, "Oh Lord, we need water." But instead, they showed that they were looking to men. It was meant to test them, to try them, and say, "Guys, your focus is wrong." It was meant to do them good in their end. Now, the problem is that first generation, they showed their lack of faith. God is good to bring just judgment. But then even Moses was tested in it. And the second rock, he failed because he didn't believe the Lord. Now, it's funny because Pastor Rob, he read Romans 8:28. I think this is Romans 8:28 in the Old Testament, right? "He uses all things together for good for those who love him and call him according to his purpose." This one, it's to humble you, to test you, to prove what's in your heart and do you good, in the King James, to do you good in your latter end. That's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of heaven and earth, the God of creation, the great I am. He is so incredible and awesome that he can orchestrate all these things. He can lead 2 million people to a place with no water just to do a work. Now that we understand those two incidents, how is this a foreshadowing of Jesus Christ? Again, when he said that the whole Old Testament speaks of me, how is it a foreshadowing? Well, let's see. The first command was to strike a rock for water to come forth. Let's look at some verses that might give an indication. Isaiah 53:5, my favorite verse in all the scriptures, right? "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed." Was Messiah stricken? More than we can imagine, and without deserving it. John 19:34, "But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out." Okay, if you guys are like me, I've heard teachings where this is the Passover. We're looking at the fact that there's supposed to be some rabbinic tradition where you take the wine and you mix warm water with it, and that's what came out. Guys, I did another search last night. Even on the most orthodox websites, you don't mix water with wine. The only time, literally, that I found, and if anybody has a correction, please stand up so it's recorded because I need the correction. The only place I saw on any page where water and wine were the same thing, it was where the wine was spoken of and then the water to do the urchats, the hand washing. That was the water. There was no mixing of water and wine, but blood and water came out, and Scripture says specifically, water came out. So our Messiah, upon which is the foundation of our faith, when he was stricken, water came out. To me, that's pretty significant. The second command was to speak to the rock for that water to come forth. John 4:14, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. He is the bread of life and the water. And when we look in Matthew 23:38-39, recognize that right after the triumphal entry, as people are cheering, the apostles are excited, and he's weeping over Jerusalem. He said, see, your house is left to you desolate, for I say to you, you shall see me no more until you say, speak it. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You see, what's really strange when you read this is that they were just saying that. This crowd at the triumphal entry were just saying, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Why would he say, yeah, you guys just said that, but now you won't see me again until you say it again? This is where I believe that future prophecy will be fulfilled in Zechariah 12:10 that says there will come a time that the nation of Israel will look upon him whom they've pierced, and they will mourn for him as a firstborn. And they will cry out, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, Yeshua, Jesus, you are our Messiah, and we've neglected you. So, he is the water, and when he comes back, it will be because he is asked to come back. They will say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So, he will come back. But just like David, if you remember, David had a son named Absalom, right, who wanted to take the kingdom. And in the picture, again, foreshadowing, in the picture of what we see, Absalom took the city and David fled. And David's armies, they won against Absalom. And they said, David, it's time for you to come back and sit on the throne in Jerusalem. And he said, no, only 11 tribes have asked me to come back. And I will not come back until my own tribe, the tribe of Judah, asks me to come back. I believe you see that as a picture once again. As David is a type of Christ, that Messiah will not come back until he is asked by his own people. So if your heart, like mine, beats for Jewish evangelism, I am excited for the opportunity to share the faith with Jesus, with Jewish people, because one of those people may be, I have no clue what the Lord's plan is, may be one of those people who ends up saying, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, and the Lord comes back. So, that's the two rocks. But I hope it's okay. Today, guys, is the International Day of Prayer for the persecuted church around the world. Voice of the Martyrs, they're very big on promoting it. And so I was hoping that along with the congregation, we would pray for the church in the world who are being persecuted. So I'd love to end with that. Thanks. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for an opportunity to be in your word with a group of brothers and sisters who adore you, love you. And Father, we might be able to see just a glimpse of the important and amazing words that our Messiah said, and that the whole of the Old Testament speaks of him. So Father, thank you so much for that. And right now, we know, as Scripture says, that when one in the body rejoices, we rejoice, and as one in the body grieves, we all grieve, Lord. Lord, we want to lift up those believers throughout the world who are being persecuted, real persecution, Lord, not just being made fun of, Lord, but their lives are at stake. They've lost loved ones. They're in prison only for their faith and abiding in you. Father, I pray that with all things, as your kingdom is coming in your timing, Lord, that you would please strengthen them. Pour out your grace upon them. Use them, Lord, because they recognize that you've paid, they are bought and paid by the blood of our Messiah. But Lord, that you would use them, use their suffering, give them joy through it, Lord. Make your name famous and make your name known through them. Lord, we love you. I pray that we'll, for the rest of our day, we'll actually remember to pray for them and think of them. In the name of our precious Messiah, Jesus. Amen.
Cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit in itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
Would you stand with us?
Please keep my eyes fixed on you. Please rule my heart. Keep me abiding.
keep me abiding, keep me abiding, keep me abiding, that I, oh, that I might bear fruit. Keep me abiding, keep me abiding, keep me abiding, that I, oh, that I might bear fruit.
Jesus, we ask you, Lord, to be that vine dresser in our lives. But those things, God, that are not productive, those things that are not producing fruit, God, you would remove. Father, that you would make us fruitful, that we could bear fruit, Lord, to bring glory to your name. Holy Spirit, we ask you to fill us, strengthen us, and empower us to walk in faith to a God who deserves to be believed in with all that we have, our heart, mind, soul, and strength. You are good, and we love you, and we do all of this in Jesus, our Savior's name. Amen. Please don't leave this morning. If you need prayer, we have the elders up front to pray with you and for you. God bless you.